Our next speaker is someone who has been tried, tested, and challenged in ways most of us will luckily never have to be. When David Benson joined the Teach First program in 2004, and when he became the head teacher of Kensington Old Ridge Academy in 2013, never could he have imagined the strength of leadership he would one day have to call upon to support his community of staff, students, and families. Earlier in June, when the unprecedented tragedy of Grenfell Tower unfolded all over international news and social media, that community were not dealing with some abstract notion of horror, but rather with very real human loss. He's joined here today by his head boy and head girl, Kai Chappelle and Titilayo Bambose, to share their incredible story of leading through a seemingly impossible challenge. Please warmly welcome them all to the stage now.
Good evening, everyone. Thanks so much for having us today, and thank you, Ndidi, for that introduction. I'm just getting used to this setup. Right, here we go. Yes. My name is David Benson. I'm a Teach First ambassador from 2004, which was the second cohort, and I'm principal of Kensington Aldridge Academy. I was asked to come here today to talk about the leadership lessons that we learned from the Grenfell Tower disaster, as my school is based immediately next to the tower. And, you know, like so many parts of that community, we've been very badly impacted by what happened. If the school has responded well and played an important role in the community since the fire, and the consensus from parents and from students and from community groups is that it has, and I assume that's why I've been invited here today, then that is because of the very solid leadership systems and structures which we have developed and strengthened and embedded over a long period of time. That wasn't something that we could just do on June the 14th. So I suppose what I'm saying is that if we're talking about leadership in a difficult time, we're actually talking about good leadership generally. And everything I say is generically a good thing to make a school successful, but becomes particularly important in a time of crisis. So for example, we have great people at KA. Schools are, as you know, people businesses. They run off the talents and the energies and the goodwill of their staff. And part of the reason we were able to come through Grenfell is because we have an excellent staff team and always have done. We have a very strong staff culture at the school. So people at KA are naturally collaborative. They're naturally supportive of each other. Now, from a leadership point of view, there are ways as a head you can encourage that kind of culture. Things like mentoring and coaching and co-planning and co-teaching and observation and training and other things like that. And if I had more time, I would talk about them. But what I'm saying here is, thank goodness we were operating in an environment which was mutually supportive, because then that became the bedrock of everything we did to get through that crisis. We have excellent relationships between students and staff based on mutual respect. They were particularly important. We have really strong values. My school's a brand new school. We opened in a brand new building just with year seven, and we've grown year by year. And part of the opportunity in that is that you can set out explicitly what your culture and what your values and what your ethos is. And that has really helped. The students are going to talk a bit more about that. We have an excellent middle management and senior management team, and that really came into its fore during the crisis. And we have an excellent and crucially extremely experienced governing body. And so those, I think, are the features that really helped us through it. Before I talk to you about the recent history of the school and Grenfell, I need to give you some context on who we are. So KA is a non-selective community-based school in Ladbroke Grove. We were a new building, the last of the large secondary schools that was built under the Building Schools for the Future program. So we're very lucky to have a brand new, purpose-built, shiny new facility. We opened in September 2014, just with year seven, and we had 500 applications for 180 places in that first year, which is pretty good for a brand new school. Applications have risen year on year since then. Our model at Kensington Aldridge is heavily influenced by the work that I did as a deputy head at a school called Ark Academy, which is just around the corner. And the work that we did at Ark Academy was heavily influenced by the time that we spent at Mossbourne Academy when we were setting up ARC. Both Mossbourne and ARC Academy are, like KAA, brand new schools that started just with year seven. So our school is unique and it's distinctive, but it's also unashamedly standing on the shoulders of giants. And that feels pertinent today as I speak to this network of people, because there are things that great schools do which are replicable, and there's professional knowledge within the sector that we need to share, and I was very lucky to have worked in those two excellent schools. Last year, we opened a sixth form, supported by the links the school has with Godolphin and Latimer and Charterhouse. The sixth form quickly became heavily oversubscribed. I'm a big fan of sixth forms, by the way. If any of you teach in schools that don't have sixth forms, I think, you know, at some point in your careers, you should definitely get that experience. They are game changers in terms of the ethos in the school and also the quality of teaching and things like being able to recruit and retain the best teachers. But our sixth form was new last year and quickly became very popular as well. In time, our sixth form will be made up of our own students coming through, but for the first few years, it's students coming from other local schools. So we are now in our fourth year of operation. Seems to have gone very quickly. We have 960 students, six of our eventual 7 year groups. We have Teach First people represented at all levels of the organization. So myself as the principal, I have members of the leadership team who are Teach First alumni, middle managers and classroom teachers. And Teach First, alongside other providers of initial teacher training, are a very important part, a very important partner for us. So although we are a young school at KAA, we aspire to be one of the top academies in the UK. And we've always been building towards this. We're looking forward to our first Ofsted inspection and we'll be pushing for outstanding. And there's a couple of quotes here that just underline the standards in the school. So the Department of Education were kind enough to describe us, this is all before Grenfell, as one of the best academies that they've ever seen. And David Carter, Sir David Carter, who's the National Schools Commissioner, has talked about how he was inspired by visiting the school. This image behind me shows the proximity of the school to Grenfell Tower. And I think it's important to note at this stage that there are a large number of schools, generally primary schools, that were badly affected by Grenfell. So we weren't the only school, but we were uniquely badly hit, both in terms of the number of student fatalities, but also the fact that we lost our access to our school building as well. So it was a hugely emotional time. We lost five students, among the most beautiful young people you could ever hope to meet and teach. But we also lost our physical environment that we were used to as well. We had to move to two other schools, I'll talk about that, for the last 5 weeks of the academic year, and then this year we're based in temporary accommodation. So we will go back to our lovely building from September 2018 once the tower has been wrapped and the area has been declared safe. So what did we do? Well, we were closed for 2 days, and in that 2 days we had two priorities, really. The first was trying to establish as much firm information as we could get about what had happened to the students and their families and some staff members who lived inside the tower. And the second was to plan how to reopen. So instinctively, we thought, and I thought as the head teacher, that the quicker that we reopen the school, the quicker that we can bring the school community together and we can start to address this. It was an inherently unpredictable situation. No one really had an idea about what the atmosphere in the school would be like when we reopened, knowing what happened to us, but we knew that we had to reopen. The atmosphere on the ground around Grenfell in that time, and if anyone knows that community, it was understandably very fraught and very angry and not, you know, the kind of place that we would want children to be in. So we were closed for 2 days. I told all the staff to stay at home for 2 days. They completely ignored me because I said there's no point, you know, the school's closed. They completely ignored me and they all came in and they were on the ground around the school. And that was good because we had some face-to-face interaction with the students and the parents. And then we reopened after 2 days. Basically, by rewriting the timetable and splitting the school across two sites of other local schools. So we co-occupied two local schools that happened to have available classrooms and we kept going. I've got some images of that here. So this is an end-of-term House assembly just 5 weeks after the fire that took place in a primary school hall, because that's where we were using at the time. But essentially, you can see that otherwise the event, you know, seems to have gone well. This is a picture of a sixth former studying at Latimer Upper School, which is an independent school on King Street, where in Hammersmith, where our sixth formers were based for the 5 weeks after the fire. This is a story from the BBC News homepage. So one of the things that we started to talk about alongside the grief and the sadness and the difficulty of what happened to the school was that we had to search for positives in the story, because children only have one chance in life at an education, and they as hard as it was, we had to keep going. We had to move forward. We had to try and refocus students on their academic ambitions and their hopes for the future. And this results day was a really important moment for us, because it, as a new school, with just year 12 in the sixth form, this was our first ever set of national exam results. Now, fortunately, the majority of all the AS exams had happened before the fire, but there were some exams that took place afterwards, and the students will talk about that in a second. But when we got this great set of results, which was in line with our predictions and showed that the school was in the top 10% of schools nationally in terms of the value added from GCSE to AS, we were able to celebrate that. The next thing that we did is in order to give the builders essentially sufficient time to finish the new temporary school, we decided that we would delay the start of term as far as we possibly could. So we pushed it back to Monday, the 11th of September. But then in that week, we took the entire school on a series of residential trips to different places over the UK. So that was both sort of educationally really worthwhile and physically completely exhausting thing to do. But the sixth form went to Oxford University. They stayed at Hertford College and Queen's College in Oxford. And, you know, for those colleges, I saw some stuff in the press over the weekend about Oxbridge wanting to broaden access. You know, for these colleges to have 200 students from an inner-city London academy essentially studying the A-level lessons, it was an experience for them, but for us and for our children, it was constructive in terms of making them see Oxbridge as a realistic possibility, getting them raising their ambitions, and importantly, just getting on with their lessons. And then on Monday the 18th, we moved into our new school. So it's been dubbed the fastest school ever built by the government. When I heard that, I said it had to be us, didn't it? It was going to be the fastest school ever built, because it's always been a bit frantic at KA. But it's impressive. So if you look at this, that's what the site looked like on the 27th of July. And that's what it looked like on the 18th of September. So anyone who has been stuck in a free school project or a new academy and been told that, you know, you can't possibly get anything done, it turns out you can. You know, and I have to say, we have been incredibly well supported by Hampstead and Fulham Council, who are there, Kensington and Chelsea Council, where we were originally, and by central government as well, in terms of getting this done, because I think everyone knew, once they realised that the school couldn't go back, that you couldn't have 1,000 students without somewhere to go in September. I'm going to hand over to Titileo now, our head girl. She'll talk a bit more about it from her perspective.
Good evening, actually. Our school and community has shown overwhelming amounts of resilience and citizenship, two of our core values. Over the last 4 months, I have seen Kensington Aldred Academy become stronger. As head girl, I see how much the staff and students have grown. We were moving forward for what happened in June, and the normality of the school was slowly coming back. Many organisations, schools and people reached out to us after the fire and gave us the means to start moving forward. As a result, the sixth form were able to kickstart the school year at Oxford University. The week we spent there was invaluable for our studies, but also for our state of mind. For many of us, it was the first time we visited Oxford and has certainly given us something to aspire to. The fire is something we as a school and community shall never forget, and we will never forget those that we lost as well. Our school's values and overall ethos of intrepidness are key driving forces in giving us the strength to progress. Because of this and all of the support we've had, I can honestly say that I'm looking forward to the current year ahead. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Kai Chappell. I'm the head boy at Kensington Aldridge Academy. And something that's quite interesting is when Mr. Benson asked Italeo and I to plan what we were going to say, we didn't have the opportunity to discuss the things that we could say. So what I found quite interesting is Titileo and I have actually decided to speak about something very similar, which is the school's ethos and the culture. And the school's values as well. The school opened in 2014, and since then, students have been almost indoctrinated to believe the core values and the motto of the school, which is intrepidus, which is a Latin adjective, meaning bold, daring, unwavering. It's exactly what students had to embody in the immediate aftermath and the long-term aftermath of the fire as well. On the day of the fire, for example, the majority of students who sat maths as an AS sat their AS maths exam at Burlington Danes Academy. 13 days later, there was an ASRE exam that students sat as well, and students in the lower schools sat their end-of-year assessments at the end of the year. It's resuming as normal, and it showed something that, to me, feels like resilience, which is a pretty good segue to one of the school's other core values, which is resilience. In my eyes, resilience is responding to adversity in a positive way, and I feel like if moving from our normal site at KA1 to Burlington Danes Academy and Latimer Upper School, both of whom we are forever indebted to for their immediate support, and to our new temporary site now is not an example of resilience, then I'm not quite sure what is. And finally, I wanted to speak about something called the KA Pledge, which is the mantra that students at our school say at the start of every single lesson, every single day, and every assembly we have as well. Now, students in our founder cohort, who are now in year 10 and doing their GCSEs, have been saying this every day since 2014 in every lesson. And never has it been as important as it is today. And I just want to pick out two lines for you. Today and every day, I'll be the best I can be. Every challenge I will rise to, every setback I will learn from, and every moment I will seize. Now, this pledge has been in place since 2014. And never before has it been as important as it is now for our students. And I speak today proud to be the head boy of this academy, knowing that all of these core values and all of these principles are so important to our students, staff, non-teaching staff, and everyone in the KA community. Thank you.
I'll just drop all these up. Yeah, so the strange thing was is that when we designed the school, we thought that these values, intrepidus, resilience, we thought that having a pledge that the students said at the start of each lesson to focus them on what was important would be helpful and useful things, but we had no idea how important they would become in terms of the health and the welfare and the strength of the school. But it was good that they were there because in a crisis, obviously, you need values to fall back on. I've just got a few things just to wrap this up. I was asked to think about what leadership lessons could be drawn from this. The first is the fact that KA is around moral purpose, as you'll see that first bullet. The fact that KA is and always has been a mission-led, values-driven organisation that was built with a transparent admissions policy. It's a non-selective, comprehensive school to serve the community in North Kensington was extremely helpful because essentially what we needed to do after the fire was a logical extension of that mission. It was to continue to serve the students to in a very difficult time to bring them together to help to lift their hearts and spirits when there was so much bitterness and anger and upset going on. So, you know, we had that underlying moral purpose and moral imperative in place already, and so we were able to say to staff, come on, you know, let's get to work, this is what we've got to do, and that was already in place. I've talked a little bit about what the atmosphere was like in North Kensington. What I want to say now is that it's taught me that the work that we do in school reaches further than you might assume that it does. We've all had that experience where you see a class on Tuesday and they've completely forgotten something that you taught them on Monday that they seem to have, you know, nailed at the end of the lesson, that overnight it's just gone from their heads. It can be tempting to sometimes think that the messages aren't getting through, but actually the community, you know, some parents initially were saying, well, why do you have to reopen so soon? You know, and why do we have to go to a different school? And, you know, even those parents within a couple of weeks had completely swung behind the school. And the positive or the more positive experience that the students were getting in the building, coming together as a cohort every day, was helping to ripple out into the wider community and to offer hope at a very difficult time. And I don't want to overstate that at all, because it is instilled, you know, the school could only do so much. But equally, I don't want to understate it either, because I think as teachers, it's important sometimes to know that they really do carry what you're telling them with you, particularly in tough times. I've talked about how, you know, the fact that we had a great staff team is all the success of the school since its conception is predicated on that. But if I had more time, I would talk to you a bit about staff welfare. I'd talk about staff well-being. I'd talk about how we looked after the staff in that time. But just for the moment, I'll just say that they were sort of, you know, permanent features of the daily management discussions that we were having. Know what you don't know. There's no substitute for experience. So sometimes people in leadership positions struggle with admitting that they don't know anything about something. I think that perhaps as Teach First people, we're sometimes particularly guilty of saying, I really know nothing about that. But, you know, there is a confidence and a skill in saying, look, I really don't know anything about this particular thing. Can you help me? So one of the things that I did pretty much straight away is I said to the educational psychology team and the trauma management team, I know nothing about how we manage the grief and the loss and the bereavement around this, you know, and they rolled up their sleeves and they worked with us in those weeks after the fire. They helped to script the messages that we put out to students. They helped to run staff training sessions, and you know, myself and my SLT had to go on a crash course really in education psychology, and that wouldn't, if we'd have pretended that we knew what we were doing in that area, it would have been a massive waste of time really. All our experiences stand us in good stead. So I, in 2013 and 2014, I had what can be only be described as quite a difficult new build project. You know, those of you who've been involved in new academies or new free schools will understand that they can be quite contractual and quite difficult at times to get through in this sort of working with architects and builders and that kind of thing. But what happened is when we had to build this school, it was the same team of people who were with me. So it was the same premises manager, the same IT manager, the same finance director, the same timetable, a deputy head. So however difficult it had been to build the first school, you know, that experience enabled us to then pull off this very rapid design of the new school. And I just want to say that to you, if you're in a crisis, or if you are in a difficult situation, you know, if you are staying up late to mark your books or plan a lesson because you're being observed by the head the next day, or you have a conversation with a student or a member of staff that goes badly, you know, these are all learning experiences. And I don't think we can ask students to, you know, be happy and resilient learners unless we're willing to model that learning behavior ourselves. But the last thing I want to say is this, because this is the main message to get across about what happened to us in Grenfell. Everything in the school flows from what it's like in the classroom, everything. So the results that students get, the ethos of the school, their behavior, their attendance, everything. One great assembly, for example, on revision is not going to teach the kids how to revise. Them being taught by their subject teachers every single assessment cycle, all the way from year 7 to year 13, how to revise within their subject is what will do it. So the classroom is the only vehicle that we have to drive school improvement, because 90% of the time that the kids are in school, they're in a classroom sat in front of a teacher. So if you want to do anything, you do it through the classroom. That's, you know, why teacher development, teacher training, etc., are so central to the work we do. So the reason that KAA could move from one school to two temporary sites, and then again to a third brand new, slightly less temporary site, at record speed, at the same time as adding two new year groups, because we were still expanding at that time, we moved from 660 to 960 students, at the same time as inducting 60 new staff, and all under the significant emotional stress of what had happened, is because we have a strong embedded approach to teaching and learning. And it was so strong that when we asked the staff to deliver lessons in an unfamiliar environment, the teachers were able to do that. They were able to pick up their lessons from their familiar classrooms into a completely foreign environment without missing a beat. When we asked the middle leaders to induct new staff in the midst of this craziness of moving from one school to another school without actually knowing what their new departments physically would look like, they were able to do that because they were drawing on their experience of inducting and training teachers in the past and the school-wide system. So that really is what I want to end on. It's because the classroom culture was strong and the lessons were engaging and varied and challenging and well-planned and were delivered by teachers with strong subject knowledge. So because students' books were marked and they were getting feedback, because all of the teaching and learning routines and practices were able to continue, that single fact, along with the careful support for students who were distressed with the fire, which we put in place straight away and which carries on, is allowing the school to navigate its way through this and to move forward. Thank you very much.